Ah, il y a des Belges. Ah, bah, c'est bien.
Oui, oui, des questions pour Canada.
Pardon. Parce que vous êtes belge.
Là, Cathy.
Oh, ben, t'as des fans.
Messieurs les photographes, merci d'aller vous asseoir, qu'on puisse commencer la conférence.
Could everyone please sit down? We're going to begin the press conference.
J'en profite pour vous présenter les gens qui sont présents à cette table.
Alors,
aux deux extrémités de la table, Eric et Nicolas
Altmaier
de Mandarin Film,
Nicolas Altmaier,
qui sont des collaborateurs habituels de Françoise Ozon. Je crois qu'ils ont leur sixième collaboration.
I think it's their sixth film, or seventh film they've worked on together.
À côté de Nicolas,
next
Manu
to Nicolas, we have Manu Dacos,
directeur de la photographie belge,
who is the director of photography.
On a pu voir Mobile Home. Voilà, c'est la première collaboration avec François
Mobile
Ozon.
Home. It's the first time he's worked
côté,
with François Ozon.
À côté d'Éric Altmaier, Jacqueline Bisset.
We have Jacqueline
Bisset, entre autres,
Unforgettable,
de la nuit américaine présentée hors compétition à Cannes en 1973, qui est revenue en compétition avec Au-dessous du volcan de John Huston en 1984,
Under the Volcano, John Huston, 84,
et en 2014 avec le film d'Abel Ferrara,
Welcome to New York.
And now she's back in competition. À ses côtés, Jérémy Régnier.
Next to her, we have Jérémy Régnier, who we discovered in Cannes with La Promesse by the Dardenne brothers in 1996. He was 15 years old. He was at the Cannes end, the fortnight. He's been back in competition with the Dardenne brothers. This is the first time, however, he's in competition with another director. Ah, I beg your pardon. And it was with Bertrand Bonello as well.
Excusez-moi.
Oui,
exactement, c'est ce que j'allais dire. Et en revanche,
and the Altmaier brothers, of course.
Des amants criminels et de
we have les amants criminels
voilà.
And Potiche.
De l'autre côté, Marine Wacht,
then
qu'on a
Marine
découvert dans Jeune et Jolie à
Cannes,
et qui
Young
revient donc
in
en compétition
and she's
avec
now
François
back in competition with François
milieu,
Ozon. And in the middle, we have the director of
L'Amant
Double, François Ozon.
Je crois qu'il faut toujours se méfier des comptes. La sixième fois qu'il vient à Cannes, si on compte la présentation de son court-métrage d'Europe
correct,
d'été à la Semaine de la Critique.
We had a short as well at the Semaine de la Critique.
He's been in Cannes six times,
but he's only been in competition twice with swimming. Pool.
Et Jeune et Jolie, bien sûr.
And of course, Young and
François,
Beautiful.
La première question est forcément
first question
pour vous.
For François, of course.
Quand vous avez eu envie
when
d'adapter le livre de Joyce Carol Oates, L'histoire de jumeaux,
which is a story of twins. What fascinated you more? The fact you were going to tell a story about twins or the freedom this gave you?
Because de miroir, de reflet,
there was this mirror, a dimension.
Ce qui m'a intéressé d'abord,
well, it was both things that attracted me, the idea.
Joyce
Carol Oates also had a twin, The Life of the Twins was written under the pen and pen name, in fact. I very much like the writer. I think she's one of the greatest American writers. When I saw she was writing under a pen name, I wanted to look at her novels, and I happened upon this book. I was attracted by the idea of twins. Also, I could play around with the codes of the genre. I could go push back limits, particularly after my preceding film, France, which was much more conventional. Here, there was something more playful that I could do with the theme.
Jérémy, tout le monde a vu le film.
You've all seen the film, I presume. Are you sure?
Vous jouez les deux rôles.
You play
est-ce
the
que
two
c'est
parts.
Un type de préparation différent
does this require
ou c'est
some
juste
different kind
un jeu
of preparation?
C'est
or are things very complementary?
Moi, je l'ai vu vraiment. J'ai essayé de le construire comme si
I tried to
build
up my characters
films,
as though they were two totally different
Après,
people in two different films.
Avec,
then we tried to weave things to strands together with François when we were rehearsing,
un peu peur que
and we were afraid that Louis
justement pas assez. On avait des craintes en disant
tiens, wasn't present enough. We wondered how far we could go if the character was too arrogant, manipulated people too much. We wanted to find a happy medium. I had fears about Paul as well. I thought maybe he's too smooth compared with the brother. So we played around with that and tried to find times when Paul could have the impression he was becoming his brother. And of course, we all viewed this through the eyes of Marine, because she's the one who fantasizes about all this.
A practical question.
Did you shoot one character and then the other, or were both mixed together? No, it was really great.
François immediately
set the tone and set things up so that part of the film could be done with Paul and another part with Louis. In this way, I was able really to embody each character in turn. And then I could give up one character when I had to become the other, so to speak.
Marine,
do you remember in what terms François spoke of this character to you the very first time around? He didn't talk to me about the character. He said to me, would you like to play this kind of a part? Do you have any apprehensions? And I was a bit apprehensive, actually. I had some scruples after Young and Beautiful. I thought this is quite complicated. In times, things are stripped down to the basic necessities. At the beginning, we thought she might be blonde, and then Jeremy being blonde, we thought we might change too many blondes. Well, if there were three blondes in the film, that might be too much. We wanted her to be a bit boyish as well, and that seemed to work very well.
Jacqueline,
were you surprised when François Ozon called you to offer you a part in his film? I don't know. He didn't really give me a phone call. Everything went through my agent. But I was keenly interested. I've seen quite a lot of his films. I think he's an excellent director. He directs women extremely well, and men, of course. I was in London. I jumped onto the Eurostar and came to spend an afternoon. It was a bit last minute. François was charming. He talked to me about the character. At that time, I didn't really understand what I would be able to contribute to the film. This dawned on me subsequently. I didn't know Marine. I was keen to get to know her better. Our relationship in the film is ambiguous. You have this mother-daughter relationship, which hardly exists. So I thought I should play things by ear. First question.
Rodrigo Fonseca, TV Globo Brasil. Ozon, wonderful film. Thank you. Congratulations. Could you tell a few words about your work with Manu da Costa, the cinematography? And second question, yesterday watching the film, I kept, during all the projection, with Brian De Palma on my mind. Was De Palma a reference to you in this film?
Première question sur le travail avec Manu Dacosta.
Question on your work with Manu Dacosta. Well, maybe Manu would like to talk about this himself. We didn't know each other. A mutual friend talked to me about his work. I discovered several films he'd done. Lucille, in particular, Innocence, which I found very beautiful. I wanted to work with a digital camera, whereas my preceding films were 35 millimeter. I wanted someone familiar with that. Of course, young directors of photography are keen to work with digital cameras. I wanted the images to be very clinical, often surgical at times. So we talked the matter over. over and we started to talk about inspiration, the kind of images that we wanted, how we were going to shoot the film. And then, of course, this was the first time we were working together. You never know how it's going to work out. It's like working with an actor, you don't know. But I'm very pleased with our work together.
Manu?
Well, we met. It's always a bit of a wager. You don't know each other that well. But in fact, things worked out extremely well. We talked a lot together. New ideas kept cropping up. Work kept evolving. And what about the main references? What were they? This harks back to the second question, in fact. We didn't talk too much about Brian De Palma. I can't remember who we talked about. We talked more about composition. We talked about a number of films and ideas. Several ideas were discussed, and then that enabled us to create the actual style of the film. It's a thriller, after all, and it's an erotic thriller, so obviously there were references to preceding directors like Hitchcock, Brian De Palma, and I love the way in which De Palma deconstructs a thriller. He has lots of fun with it. I tried to play around with the codes of the genre in the film.
Question là-bas au fond.
Two questions, one from Mr. Rozon and one from Marine. The first question is, Mr. Rozon, they call you Woody Allen of France because you make so many films. In fact, right now there's a film of you also on the screening, which is very different. But is it the case that because of the success that a lot of films have had that are more conventional, more blockbuster, now you see a room to explore more, like your more radical visions, let's say, which we see in this film? And do you think in future your direction is... where do you want to go? Are we going to, see more crazy stuff or is this a stop? And from Marine, I want to say that this is the second film you work with François Ozon, and you're very young, so this is one of your first films, and two of your most memorable performances seems to have been with him. Do you think his direction, the way he has directed you, these stories have really changed you as an actor? Do you think they have, left a sort of a mark in you as an actor, in your performance?
Vas-y d'abord.
Okay. Je crois que j'ai... Bon, ça revient.
Tu veux que je réponde d'abord?
You want me to answer first?
Déjà la question?
I can't remember the question.
Ah, où est-ce que j'allais?
Voilà.
C'est vrai que
tous des films chaque année traduits.
J'ai qu'un film à Cannes. Hein.
I only have one film in Cannes. There's only one film in Cannes this year.
Ah, d'accord.
France.
Oui, mais il est sorti l'année dernière.
Yes, but it was released last year in France, in fact.
Un film par an.
You do about one film a year. I love filming. It's a great pleasure to make films. I have a lot of friends, directors who need more time. But that's my natural pace. So long as it's a pleasure for me, and so long as I can shoot films, and I have producers who support me, people who put up the money, and things to say, of course, I continue to make films. What's interesting, of course, is to work in different directions. I'm a pretty versatile director. I don't like to repeat myself. Certain themes keep cropping up in my films, but I always try to test out new things and go deeper into some matters, but using a different genre. Well, François obviously has been very important in my career. With Young and Beautiful, I felt a bit like a young lab assistant who had to learn the ropes. I have such confidence in François, and I have greater confidence as time goes by. We've remained very close friends. Indeed, in La Mandouble, I dare to do other things with François and Jérémy.
Monsieur.
Bonjour, Alexandre Boiro.
Alexandre Boiro.
D'abord, bravo pour le film.
Congratulations on the film. Congratulations to all concerned. I have a question for François mainly and also for Marine and other actors. Since your last in competition in Cannes 4 years ago, how do you view the evolution of the cinema? Everything moves at top speed with digital technologies. How do you view the future of the cinema? And have you changed in the way you make films since the time you were last here in Cannes with Young and Beautiful? Wow, that's quite a question. I have the impression that I continue to evolve and progress. Filmmaking is changing indeed. People watch films in different ways. I believe the cinema is still there. It's resisting. People still go to movie theaters to see films. Here you are in Cannes. That shows that people are still keenly interested in the cinema. I'm confident about the future, even if I realize that we're going to have to change in terms of production. But the question perhaps should be addressed to the producers. Since Young and Beautiful, I've continued to work in the same way. Okay, production, that of course is evolving, considering what's currently happening. Eric, Nicolas?
La question est très, très large.
It's a very broad question, probably too broad. As we're all here in Cannes together, it shows that the cinema, the film industry, is still very much alive. Of course, you have financing, you have the formats, but we'll always need stories to tell. And François has lots of ideas up his sleeve. Would anyone like to add anything?
Oui, mais... question. Vive le cinéma.
Long live the cinema.
Bonjour à tous, à toutes. Déjà, bravo.
Congratulations. It's an outstanding film. The acting, the screenplay, everything is great. François, we've talked about photography. It's a very graphic film. There are lots of mirror images. How did you go about making the film, and what are you trying to convey? It's a beautiful film, but it's perhaps crueler than Young and Beautiful. Young and Beautiful was very romantic. I nearly cried. The same for some of your other films. The New Girlfriend, for example. Did you want to be more cruel in this film? It's the story that dictates the way you tell it, in fact, and the genre. The character, of course, is looking to unravel a secret. She starts by working on herself to understand what her own secrets are. So a thriller was the right genre. It's a sort of a parallel to her psychotherapy, her psychoanalysis. She's looking to discover a mystery, and the spectator discovers the mystery with her. Yet one discovers that the problem is within the character. I wanted the film to be built in an architectural manner. We worked hard with on the set, the mirror effect, the symmetries. We were playing around with the idea of the two twins. They appeared identical. They acted in a similar way in some respect. We shot in natural settings more than in a studio, contrary to my preceding film. So we wanted the environment to express what was going on inside the characters, particularly Chloe.
Madame?
Ramarashti Arabian Gazette, from Dubai. Je voudrais vous saluer pour votre film et les performances des acteurs.
Congratulations on your film. And the acting is stupendous.
Je voulais aussi saluer les effets spéciaux.
I liked the special effects. I was deeply impressed by them. Made in France, by the way, as well. I have a question on this quest. You lead us through the meanders of the mind and the soul of Marine with a view to approaching a truth. And now, what is that truth? Then I have a more pragmatic question in terms of the Arab world. Women play a central part in this film, like many other films you've made. There are a number of scenes where people are nude. Are you going to distribute the film in the Arab world? I'm not a distributor. I don't distribute my own films. I hope, however. Well, I don't know whether my film has been released in Dubai. Did you see some of my preceding films in Dubai? Swimming pool. In some Arab countries, I was asked to cut out the scene where Catherine Deneuve kisses Fanny Ardant.
Donc après la vie des films, on espère toujours que les films
voyagent. Of course, you always hope that your film is going to travel around the world.
Dans le monde arabe.
I hope my films will come to the Arab world too.
Après, c'est vrai que la représentation de la nudité pose beaucoup de problèmes dans certains pays.
Of course, nudity is problematical in some countries. I recognize that fact, particularly if you see what's happening on the internet. Sometimes people are being extremely prudish. But yes, why not release the film in those countries? I don't remember your first question, the quest for the truth. What is the truth, in fact? I'm not going to tell you what the truth is because you've seen the film. It's what happens at the end. That's what I was saying earlier on. What interested me in this final revelation, which doesn't exactly exist in Joyce Carol Oates' book, I discovered that what happens at the end is something real. I did a lot of research work on twins, the mythology surrounding twins. I discovered that one could have a parasitic twin within oneself. It struck me as so amazing, so incredible, so much more horrible than anything one could imagine. I therefore wanted to reach this end and this revelation.
Roberto Schinardi, Gay Poeniti.
Roberto Schinardi, I have a question for Marine Barthes and Jacqueline Bisset. How did you build up your character and how did you work on the ambiguous, erotic side of your character?
J'ai tout joué au premier degré.
I took things for what they were at face value.
J'ai tout joué, voilà, au premier degré. Et puis pour ce qui est du côté érotique.
As to the erotic side of things, it's François.
C'est toi aussi un peu.
Well, it's you too, to a degree.
En tout cas, les scènes de sexe ou d'amour.
These sex or love scenes.
Toujours, d'ailleurs, elles sont chorégraphiées.
Are choreographed, worked out ahead of time. We know what we're going to do. So it's a bit like a stunt more than anything else. We just do it and we laugh a lot. Sometimes there's a big difference between what you see on the screen and the way we lived through it or experienced it. What about working with Jérémy? It was great. I like both of the twins, actually.
Jacqueline?
I have absolutely nothing erotic in the film. That's not part of my character. Well, that was cut out. Oh, it must have been back in the hotel room then. You also play a dual part. You're almost two-faced. You're almost two characters. Which scene did you like most? The verbally violent scene with Marine or right at the end when you come together again? Marine.
How do you say what deer?
Un cerf.
Un dent.
Turned up a bit like a deer at the end. I thought, my daughter is a deer, a tiny, innocent creature. Why didn't I protect her properly? She was like Bambi, a fawn. A fawn, not a deer. And she looked at me and I thought, well, how did I miss out on all that? I really messed up as a mother. Yet at the end, there's this deeply moving scene where they come together.
Madame, mademoiselle.
Juliette Michaud, I'd like to know, François, what made you want to give the part to Jacqueline? Do you remember the first time you saw her in a film? Did that have a lot of impact on you?
La première Jacqueline, fois que vous êtes venue à Cannes,
the first time you came to Cannes, what do you remember about this first time when you think about it?
Alors moi, j'ai un faible pour les actrices anglo-saxonnes.
I have a weakness for Anglo-Saxon actresses. Jacqueline Bisset is an actress I admire very much. I've seen her in a lot of her previous films. The first time I saw her, it was in Truffaut's film, La Nuit Américaine. And you were portraying an American or a British star, I think.
L'apparition de Jacqueline parmi tous ces acteurs français
Jacqueline
quelque chose
appeared
magique,
amongst all these French actors. She was magnificent,
donc,
totally mysterious.
Jacqueline Bisset a commencé là pour moi.
The Jacqueline Bisset myth for me began at that point.
Par rapport au film, c'est vrai que je cherchais une figure maternelle. I was looking for a very maternal figure. Un petit peu avec Marine, et j'ai trouvé
que resemble
en fait,
Marine.
C'est pas moi qui ai eu l'idée tout de suite de Jacqueline.
I didn't think
dire.
Of Jacqueline. Myself, immediately, it was from Pascal Aquiné, in charge of the hair styling in the film. He was the one who suggested Jacqueline Bisset.
Et tout de suite, c'est, ça m'a apparu de manière
and that really struck me as self-evident.
Jacqueline
speaks French. She's worked with Chabrol and with Truffaut and Philippe
donc,
de Broca. So I knew she was living in Los Angeles and I offered her the part. She happened to be in London at the time, so we met quite quickly. We felt that we had a very trusting relationship and that's how things happened.
Je crois que c'était pour une promotion.
I think I was here to promote a film on Jacqueline Kennedy
avec Anthony Quinn.
With Anthony
et
Quinn.
Oui, parce qu'on avait parlé de ce rôle.
We talked about
le faire
the
pendant des années.
Part. We talked
non,
about
non,
it for years, and I said, no, I've never seen the
et
script. I don't know why. And finally, they rewrote the script, and I thought, okay, that might be all right, but I didn't want to embark on that kind of thing. Because it was a bit tacky. And I ended up in Cannes.
Ils ont lancé le film de là. Mais ça,
and that's
bizarre.
Where the film
c'était
was
agréable,
launched. But it was a bit strange. It was
un
pleasant, but a bit odd.
De la Nuit
Do you remember when La Nuit Américaine was screened in Cannes? Oh, it was
oui,
wonderful.
Là,
we were all there. Everybody was here. And it was a great time.
United, very
we were
together.
All very united, very, very much together.
Très sympa.
It was wonderful.
Vraiment brillant dans une carrière.
You don't have all that many outstanding events in a career.
Vraiment, c'est presque, il y a peut-être cinq soirées.
Maybe there are
ça,
five
ça colle,
evenings where
heureux.
Just everything was perfect. Everyone came
métier,
together, everyone was
accepté.
Happy. We felt accepted, and we really had a lot of fun. We often have fun, but I'm not talking about the big thing, these big moments. But that one that I referred to was one of the big moments in my career.
Hi, Francois. Eugene Hernandez from Film Comment. I don't know if you heard, but the opening shot of your film elicited quite a round of applause from the audience last night. And I think it set the tone for, to use your words, a rather playful experience of many people watching the movie last night, which was very, very fun, and congratulations. I wonder if you could talk a little bit about the inspiration for that opening shot of the movie.
Ça fait rire Jacqueline. En fait, c'est pas le
Jacqueline
c'est pas le premier
is laughing.
Du film.
It's not the first part of the film. There's a prologue. In fact, there's a scene where Marine is having her haircut. And then there's another scene at a gynecologist. I thought it was good to start the film in such a graphic way because it conveyed the inner feelings of the character, what she was looking for. So I felt that combining the eye and the genitalia of the woman would show where we were going. It was very striking, a strong, powerful image. It really gripped the spectator right from the very beginning. It seems a bit mysterious at the start of the film. You wonder where on earth the film is going to go. And then as the film unfolds, you can understand why you have these two scenes one after the other. I learned that some people applauded when they saw that scene.
Beau,
They liked it, obviously. I think it's very beautiful myself.
J'avais jamais vu.
It's something I'd never seen in that manner, because as a man, you don't go to the gynecologist, so I was a bit curious. I was interested to see how what it's like. So I thought it would be very beautiful to start with these scenes. Did this idea come to you right at the beginning of the script when you were writing it? No, it seemed to fit in with the story. When you write a script, there are things, there are lines which seem obvious, there are some very visual, graphic things which occur to one, and I felt that these scenes would enable me to go where I wanted to in the story. What would you say about that? Things weren't exactly written in that way. François always writes quite bare scripts without many details. The visit to the gynecologist, for example,
sur le plateau avec les acteurs.
Was something which was pretty much worked out on the set. But this is something you have to prepare ahead of time.
C'est le doublure aussi, c'est pas Marine.
Il faut pas. Non, d'une manière générale, on est
in general,
on commence à bien se connaître et
we've gotten to know each other quite well now.
Je pense qu'on est les premiers
spectateurs. I think we are the first people to view François' future films. When we're surprised,
sa façon de travailler,
well, we know the way he goes about his work, and I think it's good to feel surprised. François is always trying to change, to be different, and in this film, we were indeed surprised on more than one occasion.
Je pense que c'est un retour qui aide le film.
That this kind of feedback from
Nicolas,
us helps the film. Nicolas, how would you define your work with François?
C'est une chance pour un
producer de croiser quelqu'un
comme François.
To have someone like François cross our paths and to be able to work with him. He's very prolific. He has great talent and great daring. And he surprises us. He continually surprises us and challenges us. I hope that we'll continue working with him. We never know what his next film is going to be. That's what's really exciting. And the fact he shoots films so frequently, so regularly, I think he gave you a very able answer. He has lots of stories in his mind, lots of things to say. François works hard. He's always thinking about his work. He's extremely demanding also with the people who work with him, his technicians, his producers as well. He's demanding with him of himself. It's therefore always extremely interesting and gratifying to support him in his work. He's very prolific as a director, of course. He quickly assimilates all the demands of production as well. He's deeply involved in the actual production and creation of the film. That goes hand in hand with the fact he's so prolific, in fact. He's easy to produce because he produces himself, in a sense. He's familiar with the difficulties. I was brought up in Eric Rohmer's school. He was also very close to production, and very early on, he taught me that if you want to make films on a regular basis, you have to be very familiar with production and the cost of things in order to work under optimal conditions. That enables us to anticipate the constraints in terms of financing and distribution, too. This is a beautifully filmed, very graphic film. What was the greatest challenge for you? To give full freedom to all the actors. François works very fast, so you have to keep pace with him. I realized I had to go into top gear. He's very demanding, as we've said. So you have to strike a happy balance between all these different aspects. We always know where we're heading, however. Things are prepared and worked out beforehand. So basically, during the shooting, we just feel very great empathy with all the actors.
S'il a changé, non, il reste toujours.
Has he changed a lot since some previous films like Criminal Lovers?
No. C'était très agréable de le retrouver.
It was very pleasant to work with him again.
Le dernier qu'on a fait en film,
c'était The last film we did together was Potiche.
Et voilà, c'était différent. Il y avait beaucoup d'acteurs.
And that was different because there were lots of actors.
Intimité dans le travail avec Marine, tous les trois.
We were just the three of us with Marine. Things were much more intimate.
Non, vraiment fort comme après un jour.
It was very powerful.
Pour la promotion d'un film, mais c'est vraiment le cas. Ça m'a vraiment fait du bien de travailler comme ça dans
cette intimité, dans cet échange, dans cette recherche. In this intimacy, on this quest, we were all looking together. We felt strongly united. We also felt well supported. Things were very kind and nice during the shooting.
Ozon,
François works very fast. You don't have time just to sit down and smoke a cigarette. But everyone wanted things to work well. We worked both in depth and in a lighthearted manner at the same time. I have a question for François Ozon. There are lots of cats in the film, lots of pictures of cats. Then you have that male cat with three colors in his fur. Was that supposed to be symbolical? Yes, these tortoiseshell cat comes from Joyce Carol Oates' book. I didn't know whether that kind of a cat existed. Actually, I don't like cats. I'm afraid of them.
No,
I like cats, but from a distance. I had a bad experience with very aggressive cats when I was younger. It was in Joyce Carol Oates' book. You had the tortoiseshell cat that appeared in the book. So I looked, I researched the matter, and everything is very true. I found it was quite fascinating, and I wanted to use this idea in my film. I developed the character of the neighbor who loves cats, and it was lots of fun playing around with this subject. I think cats are magnificent to film. There's a huge depth in the eyes of a cat. They appear very intelligent, contrary to dogs, which may appear sometimes rather stupid. Cats are quite magnificent to film. A close-up of a cat is very difficult because cats keep moving. It's hard to actually film their gaze. Sometimes we have to slow some takes down to get the look of the cat as we want it. Marine sometimes looks like a cat too.
Et le choix de Myriam Boyer?
Myriam Boyer is an actress I really like. She has a lot of character, and I love her voice. I wanted someone who would be charming, but a bit frightening at the same time, a bit creepy. And she was perfect as the neighbor.
On a parlé beaucoup du soin que vous avez apporté au décor de ce film.
We talked a lot about the set, the decor. It's very pleasurable to see the settings in the film. There's a lot of contemporary art. You have the museum scenes. Were you familiar with all this, or was it something you discovered? I imagine this art actually exists. When we decided to film in the Palais de Tokyo, that's the museum where Chloé works, that exhibit was actually on. Is it still there? No.
Ah bon, donc j'ai demandé l'autorisation de
filmer,
je l'ai trouvé magnifique.
To be allowed to film in the museum at the time of the exhibit because I found it quite magnificent. It was interesting in terms of Chloé's character too. She was asking herself endless questions, so I felt it was good to settle this in the museum. We talked about references earlier on. Obviously, there's Hitchcock, Cronenberg, De Palma. I had to watch Cronenberg's film again. Joyce Carol Oates probably wrote her book after seeing Cronenberg's film. I'll ask her when I next meet her.
Bon, la grosse différence, c'est que le film de Cronenberg est vraiment Cronenberg's raconté du point de vue des jumeaux, alors que là, ce qui m'intéressait, c'était vraiment du point de vue
from the viewpoint of the twins. In this case, it's told from the viewpoint of this young girl who's the victim of these diabolical twins.
Vous disiez que tous vos films étaient différents.
People say all your films are different. That's very true. At the same time, there's something that runs through all of your films. You like showing images that you feel you can't really trust. We don't know whether you're what you're showing us is real or not. You seem to love this
play with the appearances.
As a director, it's interesting to play around with images, to play around with fantasy, dream, what's real, what isn't, and to blur the borders so that the viewer has to wonder what he's seeing. Are the images true? Is this all a lie?
Une scène fantasmatique, est-ce qu'il n'y a pas une part de vérité?
There's a lot of fantasy, but maybe it conveys truth to a degree. I love wondering about these things, and this is what you see in my films, which are fairly experimental. What is it like for the actors? What's it like when you play around with appearances? Or is it what Marine says, you take things just as they look? Who should answer this question? Well, for me, it's rather special. I was playing the part of two characters, in fact. We played around with François and thought, well, is this Paul? Is it Louis? With just a look, you can show different things. Who's on the phone, for example? And then a taxi comes to pick up the character. Is it Louis or Paul? For the spectator, there are two or three ways of reading each scene. I believe that that wasn't the case for Marine, perhaps. I think I've already answered. The film starts, well, we talked about the first scene, but then there's a very lengthy monologue. Is this an idea that occurred to you when you were writing the screenplay? Because it's pretty much of a challenge. Yes, indeed. It's not easy to start with so lengthy a dialogue. The people, there are two people, there's this therapy scene, and I tried to evoke the atmosphere at a psychiatrist or a psychotherapist's office. I don't know, I've never seen this firsthand, but I imagined you'd have a patient talking about her dreams or her innermost feelings. And if you look at the film a second time round, what you realize is that Chloe actually says a lot of things, but I don't think the viewer realizes this because it's the very beginning of the film and there's so much information. The idea of the film was to start with words and then to branch out into more of an action film.
Jérémy,
which of the twins do you feel closest to? Neither one nor the other, but both at the same time, perhaps. When you try to understand a character, I don't know whether you try and see whether there are similarities with oneself. However, some aspects of me are similar to one or the other. I did my work preparing the two characters. Of course, I was looking for things that were meaningful in terms of my own private life. The first time François told me to read the screenplay and we went to have a meal together, I thought, boy, it's crazy, it's amazing. These two characters each resemble me at different times and in different respects in my own personal life. But to answer your question, I'm neither Paul nor Louis, in fact. Any other questions? Well, then, thank you very much. And enjoy the screening this evening. Thank you for having attended the press conference.